Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Could you be in the same relationship for over 50 years? Tonight on Insight, find out what it takes to make a relationship last.
My parents have been married for 43 years. Mum turned 70 in February this year. And Dad just had his 73rd birthday. And they just have this energy. I mean, from the moment I can remember, like, they've always had fun together. You know, lots of laughs. Sometimes they'll get dressed and they go out and they don't even realise that they're wearing completely matching outfits. They do bicker a lot, and Mum does love to lay on what we call the shellacking.
I think that's such bullshit.
I don't think so.
See? Everything's in the wrong spot. You're wasting water.
That's going on national TV now.
Get a life.
You haven't thrown anything at me in, God, it must be weeks now.
It's true.
I mean, that's their whole relationship. It's ups and downs, love and hatred. Dad is very demonstrative in the way that he shows his love. For as long as I can remember, my dad has been making my mum cups of tea, endless cups of tea.
I'm making you a lovely cup of tea, darling.
Thank you.
How's your tea? You're not drinking your tea, and I made you...
But it's lovely. Like, he really lives to serve her in, you know, any way possible. That often translates into endless cups of tea. I think the thing that has kept them together for 43 years is their shared love of fun and of laughter. At the deepest level, they're just so connected that they couldn't imagine a life apart from one another. I mean, they have worked really hard on their relationship. It hasn't been easy. I mean, it's a cliche that laughter is the best medicine, but it's the thing that's really kept them together, and that is going to see them enjoy each other's company for the rest of their lives.
Paul, you were at a party in 1976 when you saw Tootie from across the room for the first time. Can you describe that moment for us?
It was quite something, actually, Kumi. I went to this party with my then girlfriend, and as I walked in, I saw this beautiful, tall woman with long black hair, and I don't know what happened, but the heavens opened. There was thunder, there was lightning, and I felt like Moses parting the Red Sea as I elbowed my way through the crowd to this beautiful woman. And I just went straight up to her. I gave her a hug. And I said, look, I don't know who you are, but I just have to take you out.
Was Tootie different from the other women you were dating? What was that draw to her?
I think there was a certain energy about her, certainly which attracted me immediately when I first laid eyes on her. I don't know quite how to describe it, except to say that we were absolutely meant to be together.
Tootie, what did you think of 1970s Paul when he parted those Red Seas and came over to you in the crowd?
I thought, oh, another guy asking me out. But it didn't take long. At that party, I almost knew immediately, cosmically, that was the man I was going to marry. He looked creative, and I'd always wanted to marry creative. I didn't want to marry a boring lawyer or a boring accountant. I wanted to marry creative. And there he was.
Good choice.
Matt and Anushka, you first met when you were in your early 20s. You were working at a deli together. How did your relationship move from being co-workers to lovers?
Slowly at first. I mean, we'd probably been working together for best part of a year, I'd say, before we actually got together. I remember we went out for a drink one night, and I sort of fessed up at a hotel. Was it you or me that actually bit a chunk off a glass there? We were both so nervous. And I finally fessed up that I actually had some pretty serious feelings for her. And, and eventually we told the people back at work that, yeah, we're actually together. And sure enough, everyone at work just looked at us and said, yeah, well, that we time. Worked that out 3 months ago. Yeah.
Why did they think that? They must have seen some sort of spark between you the time you were working together.
And we were friends for a few years before we actually started dating. So there was that chemistry going on for a couple of years, actually, before we got together. And, yeah, that's... Yeah, a lot of people were saying, oh, about time. We had no idea.
Mark and Julie, you both also met at work. How did that unfold?
Well, I guess I had a video store with my family, and Jules would work in another video store, and she would do her overtime hours in my store.
So when Julie was doing her overtime shifts, were you kind of, oh, great, she's coming in again to do those shifts? Was that how it kind of moved?
Well, yes and no. I mean, we were both in relationships at that time. Jules always thought that I was a little bit tight because I wouldn't get her to stay after closing. So she wanted to stay on, but that never happened.
You've been together for 24 years now. How would you describe your relationship?
Yin and yang. Yeah. But we love going out together. We work together. We enjoy each other's company, which is, you know, it's a pretty special thing.
Tanina, you met KT about 40 years ago. Mm-hmm. What drew you to KT?
Her smile. So it was the first thing that I noticed when I first met her. But we were friends for about 3 years before we got together, so we've probably known one another closer to 45 years.
Katie, what did you love about Tanina?
The first time I met Tanina, she was looking very fetching in a denim skirt and a striped top, and she had a broken leg, or a leg in plaster,
and now
similar to today. But I just, as I got to know her, I just loved her warmth and her caring, and I fell in love with Tanina the minute I saw her.
You mentioned that you were friends first, but then Katie, Tanina called you one day.
Yes.
What did she say on that phone call?
She asked me, what was I doing the rest of my life? And I said, spending it with you, I hope.
Wow.
And hung up the phone, because it was the old days before mobile phones. I hung up the phone and drove from Hornsby to Kirribilli in I don't know how quickly that day.
That's so, very courageous.
Yeah. It was actually, because we were very new in our relationship then, and we'd just made a decision to really make a go of it, and I thought it was over, and then she rang me this particular afternoon, so my dreams came true.
And I presume after that things moved pretty quickly, you were both on the same page about where you wanted to go.
We did what all lesbians do, we moved in very quickly, got a house, a dog.
And when you say what all lesbians do, as in, hey, we're housemates.
We're housemates, yeah, that's right, yes, housemates quickly.
What were your feelings about marriage at that time?
Oh, for me, I knew that I wanted to be with Katie for the rest of my life. I felt that marriage would never be something that we'd ever have the opportunity to do, that we would sit outside society, I guess, in the context of that.
Paul, how would you describe the early years of your relationship?
Idyllic. Idyllic. Absolutely. I was a little in awe of Tutti because she has such a dynamic personality. I came from a more conservative, more sedate background, and I guess I was just absolutely fascinated by her because of the energy that she exuded and the fact that she seemed to have no filter, and nothing's changed. She still doesn't have a filter.
Did that difference kind of create any volatility at any time where you're kind of trying to figure out each other's personality?
Oh, totally. We were like a B-grade movie.
I was very fond of throwing plates at him. In fact, our whole wedding present of china got thrown at Paul and shattered against the wall.
I was happy. I hated that crockery.
So your family background made a big difference in that early time.
Yes. Well, I'm first generation Australian, but my parents were European, German and Russian, and we always spoke all together, I think.
Well, we were very different.
We still do it now, and his family was very Anglo, and they were very, very quiet and very well-mannered.
And a few days before your wedding, Tuti, you were angry at Paul's mum. What happened?
Oi. Paul's mum had said, Paul, get your hair cut. And I said, please don't. It was a fabulous brownie grey mouse afro and it looked gorgeous. But yes, of course he listened to his mother.
I did.
He had the worst haircut.
It was the worst haircut ever. And it was probably a turning point, I would have to say, because all of a sudden I was in the midst of two very powerful women. And I really should have, from the beginning, just said, no, Mum, Tuti likes my hair long. I'm going to keep it like that. Big mistake.
Katie and Tanina, what were the early days of your relationship like?
Oh, Lord.
Wow, interesting. well, it was a bit tumultuous in lots of ways. My parents struggled with me being gay, and so I had a lot of fractured relationships and conversations, and they did sort themselves out in the end, which was lovely, but that was, what, 20 yeah. years later
we
or something?
We had about 15 years when I was banned from Katie's mother's home. But we had what we call the amazing mother miracle when she rang up one day and said she wanted to speak to me, and I ordered all of a sudden got really nervous.
Because she never did that.
She never did that. She just wanted to speak to Katie. And she just said to me, I've not been very nice to you over the years and you've been nothing but kind towards me and I want to apologise. So, but that took 15 years. So we have 15 years of...
Ups and downs.
Ups and downs. Yeah.
And if you backtrack to those early years, how did that kind of family disapproval impact your relationship? Was there a point when it was nearly going to be too much?
My family didn't know I was gay. So I was really in the closet with my family at that time. But in the context of Katie's mum, sometimes I'd go over there and I would be welcome, and sometimes Katie would get a phone call to say, don't bring that woman back in my house again. So I just got to the stage where I said to Katie, I'm not going anymore. So that was difficult for Kate, because I think she felt sometimes that she would have liked to have gone home but didn't feel that she wanted to go home without me. Mm. So I think that put a bit of a strain more on you, didn't it?
Sometimes. And some of my friends used to also say to me, or, you know, just don't see your parents. But I don't know what it was. There was something I couldn't make a break. I knew I wanted to stay with Tanina, but I couldn't not see them. So we did have some Christmases that we spent separately, and then we'd always meet up in the afternoon. Or so then I guess in the long run it was worth it, but it was difficult. I used to wonder why, if Tanina was going to leave sometimes, or if it'd all get too much, because I would have felt terrible in that position as well, you know, like being left not to come and all that sort of thing, because it was a terribly isolating thing to happen. But I think in a way it actually made us a bit stronger.
Jacqueline, you're a couples therapist.
Yes.
Almost 50,000 couples divorced in 2019. What are some of the main issues that you see in those early stages of marriages that couples have to deal with?
The issues that I mostly see would be around different expectations for intimacy, communication problems, parenting differences, like not being on the same parenting page. And then the other one that everyone's been talking about so far is extended family, actually interference from extended family in some form or another. Like, that can cause a lot of problems for a lot of couples.
How influential can friends and family be when it comes to a relationship lasting or not?
I think they can be hugely influential, because people find it very difficult to be estranged or be cut off from family members. There are lots of situations where that does happen, but we have attachments to our family of origin, and so they do have a lot of influence. If they don't like our partner, or they don't like or appreciate our sexuality or lifestyle or cultural differences, religious differences, all of those things come up a lot for couples that I see and cause a lot of problems. for them.
Do you ever advise couples to cut off from their families in order for the relationship to survive?
I would never say cut off from your family of origin, unless there was something really quite toxic going on, like violence or some other kind of abuse there. But otherwise, no, my work is really around how to help people establish good boundaries and communicate, you know, what their expectations are, for their partner to be treated a certain way. All of those sort of things are quite crucial. And a lot of people don't know how to do that. They don't know how to communicate those sort of things to their parents or siblings and say, this is actually how I want my partner to be treated.
Matt and Anushka, you've been together for 20 years and married for 12. About 4 years into the marriage, things came to a bit of a head after a drink-driving offence. Matt, what was going on at the time?
There was a bit of pressure, I guess, from both sides of the family for various reasons. I mean, families have got fraught relationships at times anyway. I'd started a new career in teaching and I was feeling well and truly out of my depth there. And there was also a pre-existing issue with alcohol misuse there. After the drink driving charge came, it's kind of like a lot of the deception or the hiding was just all blown out all at once.
So, Matt, I'm presuming when you say deception and hiding that Anushka didn't know about this to the extent that it was going on?
Certainly not to the extent that it was actually going on. I would take, I guess, significant steps to hide the amount that I was drinking, or if there were opportunities when somebody wasn't around, then yes, I'd be drinking then. And, you know, if questioned about it afterwards, I'd either say it didn't happen or try to diminish it, depending on what I thought that I could get away with.
Anushka, how did you find out about all of this?
Over, I suppose, an extended period of time of watching Matt's behaviour, you see him drinking and he'll say he's had a couple of drinks, but him having a couple of drinks and the way he was behaving, you know, his words were a bit slurred or his exaggerated behaviours or the smell of alcohol in his breath. And you can sort of say, OK, well, my gut is telling me he's drinking a lot more than what he's saying, and that's something hard to actually sort of admit.
Did that lead to feelings of kind of mistrust, or did you doubt your own sense of self in that time?
Yeah, I doubted myself all the time. I would confront Matt and he would be, you know, quite shocked at the fact that I was sort of confronting him with these issues or concerns that I had. And, you know, I felt really bad for then, attacking him or confronting him with this, with my concerns. So then sort of doubted what I was sort of thinking and feeling and sort of didn't sort of trust my gut when really I really should have trusted my gut. a lot of mistrust, which has taken a long time to get past.
Matt, I can sort of see you looking over at Anushka lovingly as she recounts how she felt during that time. Obviously, you've heard this from her many times before and you've talked about it together. What is it kind of like hearing it again in this forum?
It's always uncomfortable. Sorry. Because there's no way around it. I mean, I absolutely did it. And if anything, Anushka's a bit too kind there. I mean, when you love someone, you're putting yourself in the position that they can manipulate you more so than a stranger would. And, you know, once I started to do things differently, I tried to go out of my way and actually find out, I guess, what I'd done and how that had affected other people, and I'd really tried hard to work out or focus on not answering back or trying to change people's experience.
Anushka, Matt eventually went to rehab. Was there a time where the challenges were just too much for you?
Yeah, I think once the drink driving offence occurred, and I think that for me was, it was the sort of the last straw, and I just needed to have distance from Matt and his drinking issues. And I kind of sort of just, crawled away into my own sort of hole and just needed to sort of shut the world out a little bit, because it was just all too hard for myself to deal with it. I needed somebody else to sort of come in and help out with the issues that we were having.
And at that point, did you tell your family and friends what was going on, or did you still keep it to yourself?
No, I did. I did. I had to sort of tell them. There was no way of sort of hiding that, which was probably the hardest thing for me to do.
Why is that?
Because my friends and family that love me, you know, just want the best for me, and, you know, they've also got their own opinions and feelings about the situation. I kind of sort of shut them out again as well, because it was just too much dealing with everyone else's opinions about what was happening.
So what kind of advice and what were they sort of saying to you at the time?
Well, I think a lot of advice, it was just like, well, if he's got a drinking issue, he's never going to get over it. It's going to be really hard for your marriage. It's going to be really hard to get past it. It's going to be a constant problem. Like, you haven't had kids yet, you know, maybe it's worth looking at not being together. And which is not what I wanted, because I love him very much. I didn't want to hear that might be something I might need to do, because I wanted to be with him no matter what. But at the same time, I needed space from him. But it was a tough time.
Matt, I presume coming out of rehab, there's repairing to do amongst sort of family and friends, and coming back out into that at space. How are things now with family and friends, particularly Anushka's family, who might have been saying, hey, you know what, leave him, you don't have kids yet? How has that panned out?
That's turned out really quite well then. I mean, you can't hold somebody accountable for, you know, wishing all the best for their daughter. But look, by and large, with family and friends, it was really quite supportive.
I spent our savings on cocaine.
That's probably the first time I ever got angry in our relationship.
Money is such a stress in marriage, or it was in ours.
Did you ever consider walking away from it?
Many times.
Tuti and Paul, you've been married for 43 years, but Paul, you went through a bit of a big change about 10 years into the marriage.
Yes.
That put some stress on the relationship. Can you describe that for us?
Yes, I mean, it's a word that's bandied around, but I was a seeker, in the sense that although being born Jewish, I had a great affinity for comparative religions and for spirituality, and I explored this really so deeply that in the end, I can look back on it now, realise, and certainly it came out in therapy, but it's something that took me actually away from the focus of Tuti and our kids.
And the business.
And the business, yes, probably more so than it absolutely should have, there's no doubt.
And I just wished he would have had an affair with a beautiful blonde, or bought a bright red sports car, because it's easier to deal with something that's
tangible
and concrete.
So what effect was this having? Paul's kind of exploring his place in the world, or spirituality, or however you want to put it. Was that having a sort of tangible effect on your life, apart from his absence and his focus elsewhere? You were seeing it in other ways?
Absolutely. He rammed it down my throat. And to the extent that I can't even hear the word spirituality nowadays without going, ah!
Did it have an effect on you financially? You mentioned businesses.
Very much so. We went broke twice. And it's very hard to recover from that. You know, we lost an apartment. And I remember going hungry so that I could feed everybody else. And it's just, money is such a stress in marriage, or it was in ours.
Did you ever consider walking away from it?
Many times, but I couldn't bear to. I'm very faithful, and I think fidelity is such an important characteristic in marriage, or in any relationship. And even though I had no support from anyone, and I became really depressed, and I was prone to depression anyway. Now I'm on happy pills and I'm fabulous. But yes, it was very, very, very hard. And I wished I'd thought of therapy. That would have helped immensely.
Tanina, you and Katie also experienced financial hardship in your relationship, the strain of that. Mm-hmm. Can you describe what happened there?
I might let Katie describe that.
Might be easier if I described it. Similar to what Matt described, except I had a previous drug dependence then. And I went and did personal training, and unfortunately that put me in touch with a whole lot of people I probably shouldn't have been mixing with. And it reignited my dependence. And unfortunately I spent our savings on cocaine. Yes. And unfortunately I didn't tell Tanina until all the money ran out.
Tanina, how did you find out, and what ran through your mind when you realised what had happened?
It's really crazy because I'm the one that generally handles a lot of the money things, and I was looking at the accounts one day and all of a sudden I thought, there's $20,000 missing from this account. Where's it gone? Something's happened. And I thought it was the bank. I thought, they've done a fraudulent transfer. Something's happened, you know. And then I went up to Katie and said, there's something wrong with our bank account. And
I went,
Yeah, so that brought everything to a head.
Yeah.
At that time, it was really difficult because we were paying off our mortgage and we had commitments. And I just thought, if this is going to start again, I don't know that I need this journey. But again, through lots of talking and lots of problem solving, and I guess for me, I've always known Katie as being somebody who has a tendency towards a dependence problem. But I've always known that in the core of her heart and her values, the person that she is. And I know that her drug use is a symptom of other things, not the person that she is. So that is what I'm in love with. And therefore, that got me through.
Jacqueline, how do you regain trust?
Oh, it's a really big question. It takes a lot of time and work and understanding. So when a betrayal of any sort has happened, whether it be gambling or addictions or affairs, it's really important for the injured person and that relationship to be able to understand why that happened, like what those symptoms mean, what are the underlying reasons, and to be able to see changes on a behavioural level. And many couples that I see might be with me for many months to a good solid year to work through milestones together around these kind of issues and to build trust again.
Are there any betrayals that are just too hard to forgive or get through?
There are some betrayals that are just too difficult for some couples. It just depends on the level of betrayal and the type and the resilience of the couple, what other strengths the couple have together. But there are times when the injured person just can't move past it, even if they love that person.
Katie and Tanina, was there ever a moment during those hard times where you thought, look, this relationship is just not going to work?
That's probably the first time I ever got angry in our relationship. And I felt that that was a good thing because I needed to express how I felt and I felt safe enough to do it. So that was a good thing. At that point, I questioned whether, if things didn't change, whether I would be willing to keep going in the relationship. But I was willing to wait to see what happened because I know Katie had had a journey of recovery for a long period of time before that happened. I remember asking her why it happened. And besides, you know, a lot of the reasons in terms of environment, etc., she just said to me, I forgot to be vigilant. I forgot to keep my vigilance and I need to do that again. She knew what she needed to do. She just needed to do it. So I was willing to see what happened because I absolutely love her to the core. So,
Julie and Mark, About 4 years ago, your daughter, Sarah, died in the London bridge terror attack. She was just 21 years old. How did you navigate that time as a couple?
So, at the time, Sarah was a missing person. So, she was involved in the attack, but no one could tell us that she actually had been murdered. And it was 3 days of dealing with the Australian Federal Police to get us to London to then finally identify her body. It put a massive strain on both Jules and I and our family. Though that 3 days was extremely hard. We spent 12 days in London waiting for Sarah's body to be well enough to travel home. And that time we were well supported by the Metropolitan Police. And when we returned home, we felt that we were, I guess, understanding that Sarah had been murdered, dealing with that, we were a little bit more adjusted to that situation once returning home and meeting our family. The strain on our relationship was, it was great, and it still is to a point where we always consider that, you know, the life cycle's wrong, that we've outlived Sarah. And, you know, how do you go through life knowing that? How do you deal with that? But we do need to lean on each other. So, you know, in our personal journey and our grief healing is that we really have to identify that we have different journeys, but we're a team together to go through that journey. So, you know, Jules probably won't recognise, but I do lean a lot on her, and I allow her to lean a lot on me. So, you know, as a couple, we're very strong to do that, to deal with that trauma.
So the strain on a marriage, I'm presuming, is can come in where the grief journey for each of you as individuals is different to the other person, and therefore you might not necessarily be on the same page about where you're at with that. Is that
definitely
fair enough to
say? I mean, for example, if Julie's finding healing in a particular way, I may be resentful to say, well, how can you be, you know, uplifted today? Why are you feeling great when I don't? It's something that we recognise very early, and we, I guess, understand each other and where we are each day. And so we're very mindful marriages break up after the loss of a child. And we do work, you know, all the time to make sure that we are comfortable with each other.
Julie, I can't imagine what you've been through. I think it's incredibly difficult for anyone to imagine. How do you kind of process that even now when we're talking about it again, and then the impact on your relationship and your marriage? You know, what's going through your mind?
Well, I always described it as like when you had little kids and they were in a supermarket or somewhere and they go missing for a second and you can't see them for that split second. Well, I had that feeling for 3 days. She was a missing person. So when you lose a child, your body goes through the same feelings as having a heart attack. And when people don't understand, I'm so grateful that they don't understand, because they haven't had that loss. So when we finally got to see her, we had to wait 4 days to see her body. And I had to check to make sure that it was her. I had to check all her freckles and fingers and toes and her wounds. And I had held her hand and told her how proud I was of her. And from that day on, her spirit came with me. And I realised that from then on, I had to make a difference in the world. I had to do something big, because my beautiful girl couldn't die for no reason. So from that day, I decided that I had to help victims of shock, sudden death, traumatic grief. So we've founded a charity together called SARS Sanctuary to help victims who lose a lost loved one. I can talk about Sarah all day, every day. I have people reach out, call me from all around the world. I've met many victims around the world from our travels since losing Sarah that reach out to us, because I know exactly how they feel, because I feel the same way, because I'm broken forever. And there's this horrible club that no one wants to be
in and I just want to help people, and this helped us to heal. So that's what we do now, and that's my purpose for the rest of my life.
If you don't mind, if I can just go back to that sort of grieving process in the different timelines, Julie, how did you manage those early months and probably 6 months, first mm-hmm. year after Sarah was murdered? Did you kind of try and get back into life or...?
Yes, I went back to work as soon as I possibly could. I couldn't deal with the fact of never seeing Sarah ever again for the rest of my life. I couldn't go there. My sons and my husband stayed home all the time and slept. I went back to work as quickly as I could. I did as many things as I could to keep my mind busy. I didn't actually accept or go there until after probably about a year. But now I've become very spiritual. And and I actually feel her with me every day. And I get these most bizarre orbs, and I feel her holding my hand. And for me, it's like holding onto an electric toothbrush, and the energy in my hand from that day, 4 days after she died, she's been with me and she's guiding me to do this. This brings me very much peace.
Mark, when Julie was going off to work quite soon after this happened, and you're at home and your sons are at home and you're in bed, did you ever wake up and think, gosh, how can she be heading off to work and be so busy when this is how I feel right now?
Jules never sits down anyway. Like, I'm surprised she sat in this audience so long. So, she's always has to be busy. So for us at that time, and it is approximately like... It is about that first 3 months that you are still in shock and you're trying to deal with your own emotions. So not being selfish, but I was more about myself and not being aware of where Julie was at. And that's something that we definitely have learned, is that, you know, in that very soon after period, is it was something where you are considering yourself.
Jacqueline, when individuals retreat within a relationship, then it can be easy, I can imagine, for that disconnection to happen between two people, yeah, potentially.
Yep. Yeah, it's a trauma. All couples who lose a child, the pain's just too much. And as Mark was saying, most people with an acute pain and chronic pain tend to need to look after themselves first and foremost to manage and deal with that. So being able to support a partner or children or know how to do that or manage someone else's pain is a very difficult task.
Julie, you've mentioned the charity that you have and mm-hmm. Sarah with you all the time and, yes. and the purpose in your life. Has that joint purpose been a strength in your relationship together?
Oh, definitely. We live, eat, sleep, breathe it 24/7. That keeps us going, and to have a legacy in her honour brings purpose to the loss. Like, she was needed somewhere else, so now this is what we do in her honour. So it does give us peace and healing, and it's just so needed in the world, because really, apart from antidepressants or seeing a counsellor, there's not enough out there for people like ourselves.
Sometimes we don't talk, we just look at each other. Just the look is enough.
Happy wife, happy life.
I think anyone who sees them together can see that they've still got that lovely spark, that all the years haven't really changed that for them.
Night terrors became probably a problem after my boys were born.
It's always a shadowy presence.
What kind of things do you eat in your sleep?
I will eat anything.
Are you tired?
I'm exhausted.
Sometimes we don't talk. We just look at each other. Just the look is enough.
Happy wife, happy life.
I think anyone who sees them together can see that they've still got that lovely spark, that all the years haven't really changed that for them. Mum and Dad have been married for 54 years now. They were living in neighbouring streets. Their eyes met in the rear view mirror when Dad was taking them to school one day.
I thought, oh, he's lovely, he's very good looking.
Yeah, she was a nice girl, a bit cheeky in her younger days, she was.
I'm into my Rolls Royce now.
father-in-law said, I'll give you 2 years and then you got to get married. I said, it's fine with me. And we did it. It was like a dream come true.
Even though they're really close as a couple, they're really quite different in lots of ways.
See, this is a nice one.
Say we have an argument. The best thing is to talk it out. This one's not. And talk, not shout at each other, because if you shout at each other, no one is listening. Do you remember the lemony cake that I used to do?
Yeah.
It was good, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It was a good time.
Yeah.
It was a good time. It's still a good time now, but it's different.
Yeah. Mum's mobility has really changed in recent months. She really can't move around without someone being with her. So he's on call all the time. He quite enjoys the caring role and he does it really well. And I know that she's very grateful. When Dad took over the cooking, again, there was a transition process. It's not something he'd really done, except for barbecues.
Oh, he's pretty good. Yes, he's pretty good.
Spaghetti meatballs and mixed pasta, grilled chops, because I try to fatten it up a little bit.
They often sit really close together in a way that is quite unusual.
Yeah, we always do that. I don't know why, even when we go somewhere, we're always sitting next to each other, all the time. Yeah, it's just...
We're glued to the hips.
From the beginning, yeah, from the beginning.
Valentina and Nazarino, you're joining us now from Adelaide. How does it feel to see your life in a couple of minutes like that?
Feels good.
Beautiful memories. Yeah, it feels good.
Yes.
Valentina, you were diagnosed with motor neuron disease 22 years ago. Since we filmed that piece with you, you've now been receiving care at home where you are now. What is life like for you both at the moment on that kind of day-to-day basis?
I'm grateful for, you know, my husband, because otherwise I wouldn't be living at home.
We saw your husband doing a little bit more cooking in that piece there. Have you seen another side of your husband due to your illness, and especially as you get older? What sides of him have come out that maybe you didn't see before when he was younger?
Well, he's always been a very caring man, but now even more. He's very protective of me. He just wants to do everything. He says to me, when you need something, you just call me. And we still, you know, hold hands when we can, and we're still trying to be very caring towards each other, because no one knows how, you know, we pass through life. We don't know how long we have. And that goes for everybody, to try to love each other as much as you can. And, you know, and it makes me happy when all my children come over, because we share time with them as well.
Nazarino, you pray together every day. What sort of things do you pray for?
What we pray for is that she'll get better and start to chase me in the backyard.
Chasing you in the backyard.
Yeah, it would be nice.
Valentina, you and your husband have been together longer than anyone else here. What is your secret?
I don't think there's a secret, because it's just what you make out of life. You just have to work towards it, and you just have to make that little effort to be grateful with the person you're with. Because sometimes we take things for granted and we don't really appreciate the other person. And that's why things go wrong sometimes. So even if someone does a wrong thing, you still concentrate on the good things that they do. And being together, we've had the very beautiful days, and now we've got a little bit boring times, you know, a bit hard. As far as my illness, it does some days, you know, it gets us down a little bit, my husband too, because He worries about me because I'm in pain. And he sees me sad, he's sad. So we try to comfort each other and appreciate the time we've got together.
Nazarino, looking at you both sitting there together, it looks like you two are the best of friends as well. Is that how you would describe your wife?
Yes, we're not only just husband and wife, we are friends. And we've grown old together, hopefully we've got many more years together. And I'll never lose hope. Things can, miracles that do happen, and I hope she will get that miracle.
Valentina and Nazarino, thank you to you both so much for joining us today. It's wonderful to see you and we so appreciate your time and the best of health and into your future. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Jane, you and your husband Alan were together for almost 30 years. How would you describe your relationship?
Well, it was a second marriage for both of us. I think it was a very strong relationship. It was based on a lot of love and strong attraction to each other, a strong desire to, you know, have children, have a family together, and we had similar interests and values. So it had its ups and downs as well, as I think most people would say that about their marriages, but it was on a solid foundation, I would say.
In 2004, Alan was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. How did you react to that?
I was completely shocked. He was 69. He was 14 years older than me. I thought that Alzheimer's disease was something which old people got and they just got a bit forgetful. I didn't understand that it was a terminal neurodegenerative illness. And nobody really explained that to me very well either at the beginning. So I always say that I felt like I was catapulted into a foreign territory where I didn't know the language and I didn't have a roadmap. And I thought, you know, how am I going to do this? So it was, for Alan, the progression of his illness was very rapid. From being a very confident academic who, you know, travelled the world and spoke at international conferences and was busy, you know, loved the work that he did, it was almost like he fell off a cliff and he just suddenly, he lost an awful lot of confidence. Lost his sense of self. He was often say to me, I don't know who I am anymore. I didn't feel like I was his wife anymore. I felt like I was his carer. And something which quite resonated with me that I read recently, a woman describing herself as being a widow. She was married, but a widow. So it was very hard for him and very hard for me and hard for the children.
Jane, what do you think sustains long-term relationships? You know, especially when you go through something as difficult as you've been through, a dementia diagnosis, like, how do you keep that going? How did you stay in there?
I think you really have to like each other. I think that you have to, you know, there's a lot of trust. We were best friends, we were lovers, we really, you know, trusted and cared for each other and about each other. So I think having a really solid foundation to your relationship, I think, is very important. I think particularly with dementia, because what's so difficult with dementia is actually learning how to communicate with the person. And I had to learn to understand that you know, it was the illness which was causing him to behave in the way that he did, rather than him being personally trying to being inappropriate or whatever with me. So I think it certainly helps to have had a good understanding of each other and to actually have a good, strong foundation and trust in your marriage to be able to go through something like that.
Matt and Anushka, things are pretty good for you both now. You've got two kids. What do you think has kept you both together?
The fundamentals of the relationship were always pretty good. The early days of quite a number of years, we had a lot of fun together. There's always been a lot of respect for each other. I never contemplated, I guess, not being with Anushka. I mean, it was an option that was on the table, but, you know, it wouldn't have been my choice. So I guess the relationship was kept together because we knew that there was quite a good relationship underlying it.
And we're really just determined people. you know, we loved each other and we still love each other. And we loved what we have and we wanted to fight for that and get through it and get to the other side, which, yeah, we have.
Katie and Tanina, you got married 2 years ago. What was that moment like for you?
It was fantastic. It was the best day of my life. It was pretty amazing, really, because, I had come out to my family by this time, but it was the first time we had our friends and our family in the same room together after 38 years. And it was just an amazing day. It was a day of celebration and just appreciation, really, for the people that we have in our lives.
Has your relationship changed since then?
Yeah. Oh, I think it has. It's hard to describe, because people have asked, does it made much difference? And I wasn't that fussed on getting married for a long, long time, but I actually think it's deepened my love for Tanina in a way I can't explain. And it's given us a sense, or it's given me a sense of connectedness that I hadn't felt before. So it's interesting.
Tutti and Paul, do you have any parting words of advice for couples?
I think hold your family close, love your children, embrace your friends, and of course there's love. I mean, the thing is that in spite of all the things that we've been through those years, the love has never died and it remains forever.
And there's laughter, there's dancing, there's humour. It keeps every relationship alive and vivacious.
Thank you so much, and thank you so much to all of you for sharing your stories with us.